Hello, everyone. So today I am going to read our whirligig book and start with a chapter called Party Time. There will be times when I'm going to ask you to lightly underline or circle something. So if you could please have a pencil nearby, that would be fantastic. Today I am going to demonstrate the during reading strategy of making personal connections. So every time you read a book, whether it's fiction, nonfiction, assigned to you, or your choice, you should always try to make personal connections. You can make personal connections to the personalities of the characters or how they look, or maybe you've experienced an event in their life similar to a character has, or maybe you've been to Chicago, or there is a chapter in Maine. And we'll investigate that and see if it's actually a real place or a made-up place, or if it resembles a real place but it has a made-up name. You can make connections with the emotions characters experience. So there's a variety of ways that you can use to make personal connections with a novel that you are reading. And I'm going to demonstrate that as I start today. You do have two journal entries that have to do with the commencement of this book for Party Time. After I read this, please go to at least one of them and complete that journal entry for today, and then you can complete the other one either today as well or tomorrow. It's completely up to you, as long as by tomorrow you have both done. So I am using a slide format for your journal entries, just because it's easier to add onto. Anytime you run out of room, you can just make a new slide and continue writing. So I am very excited to read Whirligig. Like I told you before, there's a lot of mature themes in this. I'm really hoping that you enjoy it. It's a quick read. So enjoy. So Party Time. Brent turned toward his clock. It was 5:35. He hated the hours before a party. A nervous energy whipped back and forth inside him. So, I know that before Amelia goes on stage at either a recital or a competition, I am so emotionally and physically stressed out. I get butterflies in my stomach. I'm very confident in her ability and her the other performance ability. But just the waiting, as you can see, I start getting anxious just talking about it. I also remember that, weirdly, I was very calm before my wedding day. Usually a lot of brides and grooms experience a lot of anxiety. I was just very calm. It felt right. But there are times when I'm sure in your lives you have had to wait for something to happen and those minutes go by so slowly. I can think of one that all of us have a personal connection to, and that is the Friday or any day before a vacation. How many of us are sitting there at 2 o'clock in the afternoon and the clock is ticking so slowly? And as much as we don't want to say bye to each other, we all want to be out of school and enjoying whatever season it is. So we're sitting there going, oh my goodness, it's only been 5 minutes. It feels like 4 hours. So your first journal entry is going to be on describing an event in your life where you had to wait for something to happen. And how did you feel? Brent focused again on the computer screen and careened through the video game's dark passages, firing at everything speeding toward him, borne along by the never-ending music. Brent! His mother's voice echoed up the stairs. Brent paused the game. The firing and explosion ceased as if a window had been closed on the war. Dinner! All right! He played on, chewing up the minutes that stretched before 7 o'clock. Why couldn't you fast forward through time the way you could with a video? He flicked another glance at the clock. 5:41. Real time was a drag. He went downstairs. His parents had started eating. When they'd moved to Chicago a few months before, they'd suddenly begun dining in the kitchen, where they'd put a small TV. Brent served himself at the counter, then took his stool at the island and watched with his parents. So as I'm reading this, I'm going to pause here and make another personal connection. My personal connection would be to go back to when I was a teenager and try to remember the dinner times that my family experienced. Because I played a lot of sports, my dinner time during high school, and since this character is in high school, mine would be, I would come home, walk in the door went to the kitchen, and on the counter was my meal with tin foil or plastic wrap around it because it was usually 8 or 9 o'clock at night. And I would eat it quickly and then run in my room and do the rest of my homework. It also makes me think of the dinner time we have in this family. Although you're supposed to sit at a table and talk and things like that, we very rarely sit at a table. We are very bad. We use our TV trays and we sit on the couch and the chair. Sometimes we make sure if we haven't had a chance to talk a lot during the day or the week to spend a weekend dinner time at the table. But usually we pick the time to watch a movie while we're eating. So that's my personal connections to Brent talking about his own family's dinner. The Friday sports news was on, annotated by his father's grunts and snorts. Brent had learned to judge his mood from these. He reconnoitered his father's long, handsome face and studied the wrinkles, fine as if scratched in with a burin, feeding into his eyes. The promotion within his car rental company had rescued them from Atlanta's heat, put Brent into a private school, bankrolled Brent's mother's furniture buying spree, but hadn't seemed to improve his own spirits. The caustic complaints about work had begun again. Lately, Brent had begun to feel sorry for him. The news ended. His father reached for the remote, which Brent's mother always put to the right of his fork when setting their places. He dodged commercials, serving the rest of the family, finely ground visual hash. Switching the control to his left hand so as to take a bite, he inopportunely dropped it when the screen showed the victims of an African famine. A child crawling with flies was wailing. Brent's father scrambled for the remote. A white woman now faced the camera. "This tragedy," she began, then was cut off. I do remember in the 80s, another personal connection I can make, that Africa was having a horrible famine and plagues, and every night during the news on our little TV that was in the corner away from the table, we would have commercials with people asking to please donate to a fund so that African children could get fed. The saddest thing was the children that they showed this author by saying a child crawling with flies was wailing. A lot of times you would see a picture of a small child, like between, 1 and 4 years old, just sitting there, and the flies would be on his eyes or landing on him, and he wouldn't even be crying. And then you have an extended belly with the ribs showing. So it was a really horrible time, which I'm sure some undeveloped countries have still going on, unfortunately. "Let's go there for our next vacation," said Brent's mother. The remark drew no comment. "I'm going to a party tonight," Brent spoke up. His father dismissed from the screen a male newscaster, then a woman selling detergent. Brent found himself thinking of his parents' former spouses.
"I wish I was," said his mother.
All three watched a commercial for the new Jaguar.
"What do you say, Brent?" said his father. "Nice lines, huh?"
"Very nice," Brent replied.
He examined his father's words for signs that a Jaguar might now be in reach with his new salary. He imagined himself driving it, observed by the assembled student body, adding to the daydream a Calvin Klein shirt from the advertisement that followed. He put his dishes in the sink. "Write down where you'll be," said his mother. He skipped upstairs and showered, scrubbing himself with medical thoroughness. Though he was in his junior year, he still only had whiskers on his upper lip and chin. He shaved his whole face anyway, then applied aftershave. He put on deodorant and gargled with mouthwash. taking his comb, he parted his straight blonde hair down the middle, confronted the mirror, then combed it straight back like the models in GQ. He worked in the mousse, imagining the hands raking his hair were Brianna's. Next, he inspected his left ear's gold earring. At his school in Atlanta, it had been the right ear, likewise in Connecticut. But at the Montfort School in the western suburbs of Chicago, it was the left. His father's corporate climb had demanded 4 moves in the past 8 years. Earrings were one of the first things Brent checked. He returned to his room and flipped on the radio. Discerning what stations were considered cool was another of his moving end tasks. No spell-chanting shaman knew better the importance of precise adherence to tradition. And keeping the right music flowing, using headphones between house and car, was as vital as maintaining a sacred flame. With the room now prepared, Brent set about dressing. It was May, and no longer rib-rattling cold. He considered his large collection of t-shirts, weighing their logos, color, and condition. To impress without risking being made fun of was his mission, the latter especially important in the case of a party at Chaz's, especially when you hadn't actually been invited. He chose khakis and his Chicago Bills t-shirt. He watched his wallet chain to, he attached his wallet chain to a belt loop, tucked the wallet in his back pocket, then couldn't decide whether or not to wear his Varnay sunglasses. He finally stuck them in his shirt pocket as a compromise, then looked at the clock. It was 6:30. Still too early to leave. For half an hour, he played video games, losing all of his lives in short order, the radio booming over the game's noise, his mind elsewhere. At 7, he took off. He drove to Jonathan's and knocked. His friend bounded out, lanky and loose jointed as a clown, wearing a Cubs cap backward and a pair of shredded jeans. Instantly, Brent regretted the choice of his neatly ironed khakis. They drove off. "So how come you need a ride?" Brent asked.
"Forgot to pay my car insurance," said Jonathan. "My dad took the car for a month. There are consequences for our acts, my boy.
Like having to show up in your Studebaker instead of my Mazda MX-6. "It's a Chevy, not a Studebaker." Jonathan winced wearily.
"No kidding."
A sense of humor was a luxury that Brent had never been able to afford. He was always the new kid, stumbling through the maze, never quite rich or good-looking or athletic enough to join the elite, unless he played his cards right at the party tonight. So in a future session with our book, we are going to discuss conflict. Right now, what I would like you to do, and I'm not sure that you can see this very well, but on page 7, I would like you to underline gently this sentence and put conflict there. So it begins with "he was always the new kid" and ends with "to join the elite." And please note again that the word conflict, you can write it gently on the side.
"So how do you get there?"
"Get on 355, said Jonathan. "I'll show you."
Brent drove through Glen Ellen's maple-lined streets. Chaz lived all the way across the city in Wilmette, on the lake. Montfort drew from all of Chicago. It was Brent's first private school. He cheered when he'd heard that his father would be making enough money to afford the tuition. Then, when they moved from Atlanta in March, he found that, measured against his new peers, he was suddenly a lot poorer than before. Getting any respect at Montfort was going to be like climbing a glass mountain. So I don't have it here, but again, on page 8, I do want you to put in the word conflict right at the top of page 8 when he finally found out that he was poorer than most of the students now that he was at a private school. And again, we will talk about that in our second session of our book. I'm going to stop there. We are on page 8. I hope you've enjoyed the beginning of the book. We've learned a lot about Brent's mother and father and himself and his friend Jonathan. We've learned about setting. You may want to jot a few notes down just in case we need to refer back to them for future assignments.